Hi everybody, I'm Frank with FJB Custom Woodcrafts, and in this video I'm going to show you the process of machining the part we created in last week's tutorial on my CNC machine. I hope you're just as excited to see the process as I am in showing it to you. The machining process actually took about 4.5 hours, but I've condensed the process to 10 minutes by speeding up the video. After that, we'll inspect the parts, check the fit, glue and clamp them together, and after the glue dries, we'll begin removing the excess inlay material. Once that's done, I'll show you the simple finishing process that I used to get this result. To begin, I firmly clamped the maple base material to the CNC table and then set the XY datum position to the bottom left of the material. After that, I set the Z0 position to the material surface. You'll see me set the Z0 position for the V bit when we change bits. I then loaded the Toolpath clearance file into my CNC software and began the clearing process. You now see me changing the tool to a 90 degree V-bit, setting the Z0 position, and running the V-carve toolpath. While the clearance toolpath only took a few minutes, the V-bit toolpath took about 2 hours of machine time. After removing the part from the CNC and admiring the result, I firmly clamped down the cherry inlay part so that the bottom left corner was placed at the XY datum position, and then Z-zeroed the half inch end mill to the surface of the material. I then ran the clearance toolpath, changed to the 90 degree V-bit, Z-zeroed it, and ran the V-carve toolpath. Now, I can admire the results and visually compare the parts. If it wasn't clear in the previous tutorial why the inlay toolpaths needed to be created from the mirror image vectors, it should become clear now. The inlay needs to be a mirror image of the base, as the inlay needs to be flipped horizontally to fit into the base.
I previously removed any fuzzies from the carved areas with an abrasive brush on my Dremel tool. I then tested the fit. Ah, perfect. As you can see, there is a small gap between the base and inlay boards. That's the 0.02 inch gap that we built into our toolpaths. The same amount of gap is present between the bottom of the inlay and the top of the recesses in the base. This allows space for glue so that excess glue doesn't prevent the parts from fitting together properly. After applying glue in the V-carved recesses in the base, paying particular attention to make certain that glue completely coats the lateral V-carved edges of the recesses, I clamp the parts together and let the glue dry overnight. The next day, I created a quick rectangular shaped pocket toolpath to remove excess inlay material, leaving a small amount of excess. After that, it's best to sand the remainder off with the hand sander until you're left with a beautiful inlay. I use a random orbit sander, followed by hand sanding in the direction of the wood grain to remove any orbital sanding marks. After removing all sanding dust from the parts, I wiped on 2 coats of natural color Watco Danish oil to finish the project. If you look at my final project carefully, notice that many of the horizontal, elongated, triangular shaped elements present in the original 2D vector image on the roof and door of the cabin did not turn out that way on my finished project. What happened? I made a mistake and didn't follow my own advice, since I was in a hurry to sand off the excess inlay material. Rather than sand off the remaining excess inlay material with my random orbital sander, I decided to try running it through my panel sander. Bad idea. I took off a little too much material and sanded off some of the inlay, specifically the shallower, narrower parts of those elongated triangular elements. If I had followed the advice I'm giving you, then the inlay would have matched the cabin vector perfectly. Lesson learned. Other than that, the inlay fit perfectly with no gaps and no chip out. I still think the project looks great, and I plan on enjoying it in my own home. See you next time.